The story of an Armenian merchant during the forced deportation, İbran Osyan, and in Turkish, Tehcir'de bir Ermeni tüccarın hikayesi, İbran Osyan. Thank you very much, Uya.
Welcome. Öncelikle şunu...
First of all, I would like to say that this is the initial draft of my research, so I would be very grateful for any contribution, any criticism, especially if you could recommend me new resources, I would be very happy. So if you could present me your contributions, I will be very happy. And another note on the title of my presentation. It says the story of an Armenian merchant in deportation, İbran Osyan. Well, in Latin letters, it says İbran Osyan, but I use the version İbran Osyan because in the Ottoman documents, it's most frequently written as İbran Osyan or Abran Osyan, but the most correct version, I think, would be İbran Osyan. So let me introduce my topic. Deportation has been the destruction of both human capital and cultural capital for the Armenians, and the most important thing is the abandoned properties, envali metruke, or the abandoned properties, and what happened to these properties. Recently we are seeing that important research has been carried out on this topic, but the but what happened to the abandoned properties or the properties of certain merchants, this is still a topic that is limitedly researched. So in this presentation, I will talk about the story of Marike İbran Osyan to the extent that it was reflected on the Ottoman documents. So in order to fill the gap in this topic, I think it will be a small step taken. Marike İbran Osyan, together with his brother Merike, was the owner of İbran Osyan Brothers and founder of İbran Osyan Brothers, an important enterprise in Turkey, in Anatolia, Amasya, Samsun, Konya, Kayseri, Sivas, Yozgat, Merzifon, were the cities whereby their goods were sold. So it's a chain of stores. And at the same time, in Amasya, they had a factory producing textiles, and through ships, they were also involved in commercial activities with Europe to a large extent. So this important Armenian merchant had his first contact with the Ottoman state in 1908 with regards to the Armenian issue, as it is reflected in the archives. And it is that in 1908, by the Armenian committees, a letter is written saying that they want money from him, and if he doesn't give money to the Armenian committees, he would be killed. So İbran Osyan complains to the police department about this letter. And the Ministry of Interior and the police department, as far as we can see in the documents, issues an order to protect him, his family, his stores, and all his assets. So an order is issued by the police department for his protection. So this event took place in 1908, and Marike İbran Osyan is actually creating his first image vis-a-vis the Ottoman administrators. He is a person involved in drapery merchant. He is putting a certain distance between himself and the committee members. So in the eyes of the Ottoman state, he is a harmless, quote-unquote, harmless merchant. After the decision of deportation was taken, first of all, we can say that most of the Armenian society went through this displacement, but İbran Osyan didn't go through this displacement and dispossession process. He converted to Islam, he became a Muslim, he wasn't subject to deportation, he stayed where he was, and he was able to protect his property rights. So we can call him among the lucky minority of deportation process. But we have to say that his conversion or his not being subject to deportation was not a smooth or non-problematic process. He went through certain problems, and we can trace his history through the correspondence written between three institutions. Well, this part is a little bit complex and confusing, but we have derived his story from these documents. That's why I want to talk about it. The three institutions I'm talking about is the Chief Commander of Army of Ottoman, Ministry of Interior, and Istanbul Police Department. The correspondence, the letter, is written by the intelligence department to the police department. So the correspondence starts with this letter. And the army says, according to the intelligence we have received, the merchant Ibronesyan was exiled to Ankara. He was in the court and he acquitted. So please inform us when he comes back to Istanbul. This is what the intelligence department is asking for. So after this letter was sent from the intelligence department, the Ministry of Interior starts to conduct an investigation to see what happened to him. So first of all, the police department, Istanbul Police Department, was informed of the content of this letter, and they were asked if Ibronesyan was sent to deportation. If yes, why? And is it possible that he can come back to Istanbul? And the second department of Istanbul Police Department, second division, is carrying out the investigation. And they say in a letter that Ibronesyan, originally from Amasya, is a merchant who is known to have nothing to do with the committee activities. He has not been deported from Istanbul, but upon a demand coming from Kayseri Governorate, he has just been sent to the Kayseri Governorate. So the Ministry of Interior continues its investigation on the case, and they learn from Kayseri Governorate that Ibronesyan went there, converted to Islam, and went back to Islam. So they notified the Istanbul Police Department, saying that we learned that Ibronesyan went back to Istanbul. Please learn when he came back, how, and where he is residing. So the Istanbul Police Department, upon this demand from the Ministry of Interior, carries out another investigation, and they learn that Ibronesyan was actually tried in the army court in Kayseri. He acquitted, and he received a document from the Kayseri Governorate saying that he can go back to Istanbul, and actually he came back to Istanbul. So the Army Chief Commander's Ministry is informed by the Ministry of Interior that he came back to Istanbul. So this is the correspondence, a complex actually, correspondence, series of letters exchanged between three different institutions. And this actually gives us the story of Ibronesyan, what he went through during the initial months of deportation. We can deduct the following from this story. Ibronesyan was not sent to deportation. He was not deported. However, upon a letter coming from Kayseri Governorate, he was actually sent to Kayseri, and he was tried in the military court. But we don't know why he was tried there, because most of the time people who were tried in the military court at that time were involved in committee activities, revolutionary committee activities. So most probably he was also tried on a similar reason. So after he was tried at the military court or martial court, he is acquitted and he comes back to Istanbul. We also learn from the story that the police department deems him as a trustable merchant. And the criteria for this is that he has nothing to do with the revolutionary committee supporters. And to support this, they also say that he converted to Islam in Kayseri and now he's a Muslim. So he is not deported and he comes back to Istanbul as a Muslim now. But what happened to his properties? Ibronesyan, after he converted, takes the name of Ahmet Sırrı. So in the documents, we will see his name as Ahmet Sırrı Ibronesyan. And after he converts, he keeps his right of discretion on his property. On the 5th of December 1915, there is an encrypted telegram sent to many governorates by the Ministry of Interior. This document is sent to the governorate, and the governorate says that as he is converted, Ibronosian should receive back his possessions and property, and his property should be initially given to a Muslim proxy that he will appoint, and his stores should be open. As we know, the Armenians who were deported, all their movables and immovables were considered as abandoned properties, envali metruke, and all these properties were liquidated by the state, by the hand of the state. Those Armenians who were not deported, at least in principle, their properties were not touched, so they had their rights, discretionary rights on their properties. And those Armenians who converted to Islam and who stayed, who were not deported, were exempt from the abandoned properties law. So this document was sent to different governorates, and it shows that the properties of Ibronosian were initially included among the properties that were to be liquidated before deportation. What does this mean? These properties could have been auctioned or sold through auction or expropriated by the state. Well, the relevant regulations were saying that these expropriated or confiscated, let's say, confiscated properties would be given back to those Armenians who were not deported. And according to the orders coming from Ministry of Interior, Ibronosian actually had to receive at least the money of the of his properties if his properties were sold in auctions or to other people. So he has some initiatives to take back his property, or at least take back the money if the property was sold or auctioned. So he sends telegrams to the governorates and sanjaks, the districts, whereby he had properties. He had appointed Muslim proxies demanding that his property should be given to these proxies. However, in the handling down of his property back to Ibronosian, there were also some problems. Ibronosian Ahmet Sırrı, for instance, he makes a demand to take back for the restitution of his property in Samsun. He writes a telegram to Canik Governorate, and after they receive his telegram, Canik Governorate applies to the Ministry of Interior saying that the family of Ibronosian is originally from Amasya, and he has his stores and properties in Samsun, and the governorate does not approve that his property would be given back to Ibronosian because they say that he was also subject to deportation. So it means that the governorate was going to start a detailed investigation about Ibronosian. Because when the ministry takes this telegram from Canik Governorate, first they apply to the Canik Governorate saying that he is actually now converted to Islam, so he actually has a right on his property. So they say, they ask the governorate to provide the evidence to support why they reject this demand. So, upon the telegrams were received from Ministry of Interior, they apply to the police department asking carrying out of an investigation to see if Ibronosian was an quote-unquote harmful Armenian. So an investigation is initiated, and on the 3rd of March 1916, so many governors are sent a telegram asking the governors if the Ibronosian company has any branches in their governorates. If yes, if there was any money sent to the different embassies from these stores, if the people, employees working in these stores were involved in any suspicious activity. So all these governors are asked to carry out certain investigations on İbranosyan and his stores and his activities. And we have so many documents in hand. And all these documents show that during this investigation carried out by the police department, actually there was no negative information on İbranosyan. So İbranosyan, in the end, continues to have his rights on his property as a result of all these investigations. So we have someone who has had the least amount of wounds, so to speak, after the deportation process compared to the majority of Armenians. But his story doesn't end with the war. He is subject to the Ottoman documents even after the war, and the process starts accordingly. In 1920, İbranosyan dies in a train accident in Romania. So this unexpected death of İbranosyan brings about the question of who will inherit this rich merchant's goods, properties. The problem is that according to state records, İbranosyan is seen as a Muslim. And according to Islamic inheritance law, if you are from a different religion, you can't have an inheritance right. So non-Muslims cannot benefit from they cannot be considered as heirs. And under these conditions, the state says that the inheritance cannot be received by non-Muslim relatives of İbranosyan, unless there are some non-Muslims that are specifically listed in his will. Apart from these people who are specifically listed in his will, the share of the inheritors will be transferred to the state. So again, another series of letters is exchanged. At this point, unfortunately, I don't have any information that confirms the following. I will continue my research on this. Did İbranosyan convert back to Christianity before the train accident? I don't know clearly this, if he was still a Muslim, or if he wrote any specific names in his will, any non-Muslim people, because somebody claims that he converted back to Christianity and that his grave is in the Armenian Christian Armenian cemetery, so this can indicate that he actually converted back to Christianity. But according to the Ottoman records, he is still seen as a Muslim, a converted Muslim. So within this framework, his inheritance should go back to the state treasury. That is the claim. So some initiatives are taken on this regard. So I don't want to take much of your time, so I won't talk about this final process, but I can say that with the death of İbranosyan, yes, I'm wrapping up. With the death of İbranosyan, his properties are now included among abandoned properties. So in the process to follow, the inheritors of İbranosyan, well, by the way, they tried to take their share from his properties, but the documents available show us that they haven't succeeded in taking their share. And as it seems, the properties and wealth of İbranosyan is transferred to the state treasury. But I also would like to say that the properties that are transferred to the treasury are those that belong to him as an individual. The properties of the company, his companies, were actually subject to a great conflict between the Ottoman state and the other shareholders. And the shareholders of the company say that the properties belong to the company, that's why they cannot be transferred to the state, especially his ships, because confiscating ships was an important thing at that time. That was the main focus of the conflict. Confiscation of the ships created a lot of discussions between the shareholders and the Ottoman state. So the shareholders made some initiatives not to give the ships of the company, but as it seems from the documents, his properties, İbranosyan's properties, have been included among the abandoned properties upon his death. Thank you.
And
Oya Gözel Durmaz'a çok teşekkür ediyoruz.
Miss Gulbenkians, thank you much for this highly interesting story. This goes to show that micro stories can lead to big problems and that they create certain bottlenecks.
Is Jonathan Conlin from University of Southampton, Department of Modern History. And the paper is entitled Very Loyal Subjects and Friends of Our Country, the Gulbenkians and Ottoman-Turkish Economic Development 1850-1930. Ve Türkçe olarak, biz ülkenin en sadık tebaası ve dostları, Gulbenkian ailesi ve Osmanlı'nın Türkiye'nin iktisadi gelişimi 1850-1930. Thank you.
Günaydın, good morning. In 1923, Gallus Gulbenkian was a frustrated man. For several years, he had been trying to attempt to restore family properties that had been confiscated by the Turkish authorities. One of them, Gulbenkian Han, shown here, it's still there, and still in the hands of the government ministry for Vakfs in the neighborhood of Sirkeci. This Han was restored to him only to be confiscated all over again, so some of his properties were confiscated twice. Gulbenkian's model farm at Mutuveli near Manisa in western Anatolia had first been vandalized by local Greek peasants, and then when the Greeks fled in the face of the advancing nationalist army, the army killed Gulbenkian's two managers, stole what they could, and then the state confiscated the farm in the name of the new Republic of Turkey. The struggle for restitution was not without its humiliations. Gulbenkian agreed to enlist an Istanbul grocer, referred to as Epicier Ahmet, who had helped with certain confiscated properties in Büyükdere. Quote, "My God, what a pretty pass we have come to," he complained, "obliged to get some grocer to report on our farm. This is a pitiful state of affairs," end quote. It was the low social rank of Ahmet, rather than his ethnicity, which rankled Gulbenkian. At low points, Gulbenkian wondered if the game was worth the candle. Yet he chose to continue the struggle for restitution, corresponding regularly with his agent in Istanbul, also a relation, Dikran Turabian, for more than 30 years. Clearly, for Gulbenkian, this was more than a matter of business. When former Young Turk Finance Minister Cavit Bey telephoned him a couple of months later from Lausanne to sound him out about Mosul oil, Gulbenkian was a bit shy, a bit cagey. A lot had changed, after all, since 1910, when Kallus Gulbenkian and Cavit Bey had worked together to set up the National Bank of Turkey, and when Kallus Gulbenkian had been an Ottoman diplomat in Paris and London, helping to negotiate the Ottoman loan of 1911. There had been the genocide, obviously the confiscations, World War I, and many other events. Gulbenkian was no longer an Ottoman diplomat in 1923. Meanwhile, for his part, in his 1917 budget speech, Cavit had argued that even if the confiscations might be illegal, they were justified on the account of the boost they had given to, quote, economic entrepreneurialism, end quote, of the Turks. And by Turks, he obviously did not include Armenians. In December 1923, Gulbenkian nonetheless decided to use this reopened channel to make a direct appeal for restitution of his family's properties. His letter to Cavit struck a surprisingly defiant tone. The confiscations had been, he began, carried out on the pretext that his family were fugitives, a label that he saw as insulting. "We have at all times been very loyal subjects and the friends of our country. I assure you that I resent such treatment most deeply on account of my relations and my position." Despite this appeal, nothing happened. In 1925, Gulbenkian turned to the former Khedive of Egypt, a close friend of Kemal. The Khedive reassured Gulbenkian that Kemal had given strict orders that the Gulbenkian's properties were not to be touched. Yet, as Gulbenkian noted, quote, "instead of respecting them, they have taken yet more." 10 years later, in 1935, Kemal and his Council of State signaled that they did not consider the Gulbenkians friends of the country, taking the decision to strip them of their Turkish citizenship, not just Gulbenkian, but his wife Nevart, nay Yesayan, his son Nubar, and his daughter Rita. It was a petty step, only reversed in 1964, when Nubar Gulbenkian had his Turkish citizenship restored. This paper addresses the role of the Gulbenkians in the economic development of the Ottoman Empire and the Republic of Turkey. Although other more distant relations will be touched on, it focuses on the two branches of the family led by the brothers Sarkis and Serope, who arrived in Istanbul from Talas, near Kayseri, around 1850, establishing themselves as general merchants and quickly rising to the ranks of the Amiras, the leading merchant class of the Armelian millet. The next generation, led by Gulabi and Kalust, moved to New York and London, respectively, in the 1890s. Just because these Gulbenkians left Turkey does not mean that the clan ceased to be of importance to the economy. On the contrary, as we shall discover, the development of the clan's commercial activities and investments was largely unaffected by the violent outbreaks of anti-Armenian state-sponsored genocide, including the events of 1895 as well as 1915. That does not mean, however, that the clan were an atomized group of cold-blooded, rational profit-seekers. On the contrary, all Gulbenkians were subject to the pull of affection, pride, and nostalgia, as well as self-interest. And all these factors determined where, when, and how the clan chose to invest its wealth, whether that be in profit-making ventures or in charitable activities, which so often went together. Seen as an investment in human capital, the distinction between business and philanthropy becomes fine, if not disappearing entirely. This is surely a more helpful way of understanding the Gulbenkians' charitable giving than the well-worn alternatives. On the one hand, the hagiographer's depiction of Amira generosity as immutable and unlimited, and on the other, the more patriotic historian's view of it as an attempt to make up for guilty consciences. This paper begins by considering the activities of Serope and Sarkis, Sarkis being the father of Kalust, from their arrival in Istanbul until 1894, when their eldest sons, Badrik and Kalust, took over the businesses. The second part describes the events unleashed on the family by their ill-advised adventure in stock market speculation, which ultimately led to the collapse of their Istanbul company in 1906. In one sense, this bankruptcy drew the line under the Gulbenkians as Istanbul Amiras. In another, however, it simply confirmed the clan's expansion into new markets for Ottoman commodities. The final section considers the clan's response to the violent birth of Turkey, and particularly to the question that lay behind discussions over restitution of property and the resettlement of fellow Armenian survivors of the 1915 genocide. That is, whether it was still possible to imagine the clan and the regime collaborating in the economic modernization of the country, or, if not, where else the clan could invest its people's considerable human capital. Apart from a few articles and unreferenced genealogies, the role of the Amiras in Ottoman economic development has been barely touched on. Even the nature of the title Amira remains unclear. Was it a title granted by the Sultan, or was it not? While the Dusian and Dadian families have received some attention, the Gulbenkians have been largely ignored, although Edhem Eldem's recent pamphlet In Search of the Gulbenkians is an exception. None of these works, however, draw on the papers of the Amiras themselves, relying instead on trade directories and accounts by non-Armenians. This paper is thus the first to study an Amira's family economic activity using the letters that the family wrote to each other, to their business associates, and the accounts and the marketing ephemera that they left behind. This archive, held at the Gulbenkian Foundation in Lisbon, extends to over 600 meters of files, and is admittedly more extensive on Sarkis Gulbenkian's side of the family than on Serope's. It is nonetheless possible to draw out a picture of the clan's activities as a whole. I'm only going to touch in this talk on three main aspects of my findings so far. The full text of the paper is, however, available on my page on academia.edu. I look forward to receiving comments from other delegates as well as inquiries about the Gulbenkian papers, which may be of interest and use to other researchers. So first, the question of whether by integrating the Ottoman economy into the world economy, the Gulbenkians were helping Ottoman development or hindering it. In the years between 1880 and the Young Turk Revolution of 1908, the Gulbenkian clan were, it must be said, a mixed blessing. They were part of a network of family businesses that spread across the empire, including the Kuyumjian family. This is a list of signatures from a petition of 1896, in which you can see just how multi-ethnic the business community of Baghdad is. We have the signature of Kerope Kuyumjian with his signature in Armenian underneath. We have members of the Jewish, Greek, as well as Arab trading elite of this city here. Kuyumjian would have been well known to little Kalust because they had met when he was just six. This is Kalust Gulbenkian on the left, with his probably a distant second cousin, Kerope, embracing him on the right. The advantages that they brought were firstly in things like technology. Gulbenkian studied engineering and other sciences in London and then returned to Adana to introduce new cotton ginning machinery to the family's cotton factories in Adana. They also invested their money and their know-how in the Mersin-Tarsus-Adana railway. They also helped by serving as polyglot intermediaries between the government authorities and foreign banks, particularly when it came to negotiating loans. On the negative side, however, serving as intermediaries between the Ottoman Empire and the outside world exposed the Gulbenkians and other amiras to certain temptations, which represented the Western life of a rentier aristocrat living in Monte Carlo, driving around London in a nice car with liveried servants. This shows two members of the Yesseyan family in their car in about 1910, when cars were very rare and very expensive. And you can see that there are many temptations here which would lure even the most diligent businessman away from his books and away from his business. We might see this as a more individualistic approach to business and indeed to the clan as well. But individualism could reflect dynamism as well as hedonism. In Carlos Gulbenkian's case, it led him to turn his back on his Istanbul family and their business and invest in new businesses such as petroleum, leaving his family's company, Sarkis Gulbenkian Fis, to flounder and ultimately collapse in 1907. This is one of the rather desperate telegrams that his younger brothers, Karnig Vahan, and his uncle Garabed send to him, appealing to him to save them by investing in their company, which is about to go bankrupt. And those of you can see how disastrous this is. The word harabiyet literally appears there. You can tell things are getting serious in the correspondence between the brothers when they switch from French to Turkish, and especially Armenian. By succumbing to the temptations afforded by South African mining shares and the bubble that emerged in 1894-5, the clan did real damage to the Ottoman economy. Although it must be said, the Gulbenkians were not the only Armenian Amira clan to get themselves involved in this mess. Large amounts of capital that might have been put to more productive use simply left the Ottoman Empire. Trust among the business community was shaken and capital networks fragmented. We can see this clearly in the case of the Gulbenkians, where the suspicion created among the family and its Armenian associates after 1895 helped sow the seeds of the 1907 bankruptcy. They no longer could trust each other enough to help each other out in times of trouble. The second theme I want to pick out is that of anti-Armenian violence. Were the Gulbenkians drawn or pulled out of the Ottoman Empire by new opportunities, or were they pushed by the violence of the Ottoman state? In the 1880s and 1890s, the Gulbenkians established new branches in Marseille, London, and New York. In New York, it was Gulabi Gulbenkian and Company. This was a case not of responding to the push of violence, but to the pull of new markets. The violence unleashed by the attack on Bank Ottoman in 1895-6, held by the Armenian activists, had little effect on the Armenians, nor did the 1909, sorry, no effect on the Gulbenkians, nor did the 1909 Adana massacre or the genocide. However, sent to the Ankara and Sivas affiliates to collect outstanding debts from clients in late 1897, one Gulbenkian, Badrik's younger brother Hariutun, did come face to face with, thank you, with the effects of anti-Armenian violence. What had been an important center of mohair production was now a wasteland. Many of their suppliers had fled. Those that left were dying. Quote, they don't have money, Hariutun reported. They don't even have bread. In the 1890s and 1900s, the clan were sufficiently suspect for the Ottoman security services to put them under surveillance, both at home and in the United States. There is little apart from paranoia, however, to justify this. Gulbenkian's claim to Javed Bey that his family had never advocated political activism of any kind is justified. The emergence of Armenian political parties in the 1880s passed the clan by entirely, although there are some indications that there was a divide between elder and younger siblings, with the younger ones willing to play or dally with revolutionary activity in a way the elder brothers found reckless. One suspects that Kalust and Badrik's younger brothers, Vahan and Gulabi, did so as much to tweak the nose of their bossy elder brothers as from any true allegiance to the Dashnaks or any other political movement. I'm going to skip over the third element, but would be happy to answer questions about it. This is about the post-genocide question of what to do and where to resettle the Armenian refugees. Kalus Gulbenkian had been relatively detached from questions of creating an Armenian national homeland during the Versailles negotiations and the years that followed. He felt that it was best for Armenian refugees to forget about a dream of a national homeland and simply to go on with their businesses as far away from the former Ottoman Empire as possible. In 1930, however, he became president of the AGBU and was therefore for 2 years directly involved in negotiating the return. This is a complex question about where and how to resettle the Armenians, which I can't really go into. What is interesting is to note the contrast between the cousins, in that Badrig, shown here with the other great New York Armenian Amira, Miran Karaguzian, they were very keen on resettling people in Armenia, whereas Kalust did not support that. In the 40-odd years since Sarkis Gulbenkian's death in 1893, this Gulbenkian clan had expanded, experimented, and assimilated, where by 1935, it was no longer feeling like much of a clan at all. It had served the Ottoman Empire primarily by integrating it into a global economy. Anti-Armenian violence played little role in their decision-making. Unsurprisingly, the story bears striking resemblance to those of the Ralis, Ottoman Greeks, the Sassoons, and the Samuels, Jewish and other often colonial British family merchant houses in the same period, all of whom were drawn to London in this period by Britain's economic might. In 1870, after all, Britain was responsible for a third of world manufacturing output, as well as being the world's largest capital exporter. Like the Gulbenkians, these family companies had always combined banking with trading and were also tempted by the rentier lifestyle. Had Sarkis Gulbenkian survived, it would probably have struggled after 1918, precisely because it failed to specialize, as the Gulbenkians in New York did by specializing in rug manufacturing, as you can see here. They set up a factory in New Brunswick, New Jersey, Gulbenkian Seamless Rug Company. To conclude, I'm going to jump forward to 1965, when Kalust's son, Nubar Gulbenkian, famously shown here with his orchid, was interviewed by Özden Toker for a series of articles in Akis. Back in 1935, Nubar's Turkish citizenship had been taken away by İnönü. Now, 30 years later, İnönü's daughter was happily cozying up to, quote, my host, the cute old codger with the purple orchid. Nubar was his usual charming self, emphasizing his family's links to several leading Turkish diplomats of the 20s and 30s. Nubar had, he claimed, fired an Armenian priest who had maligned the Turkish state in a sermon at St. Sarkis, the Gulbenkian church in New York. Quote, "He did not have the right to act like that," Nubar said. "I did not approve of his words. Most Armenians think like me," end quote. Reading this interview 50 years later, at the 100th anniversary of the genocide, we might shift uneasily in our seat. Whatever else one might say of it, using the very different set of terms that have been developed since 1965, it at least had the merit of consistency. From 1880 to 1935, and perhaps beyond, the Gulbenkian clan were and had been, quote, "very loyal subjects and the friends of our country." Thank you.
We thank Jonathan Conlin. What a family archive. Very exciting. Üçüncü konuşmacımız.
Our third speaker is Sezai Balcı from Giresun University Department of History. He will be talking about the rise of the Greek bourgeoisie in Giresun and Captain Yorgi Konstantinidi, mayor of Giresun.
And Captain Yorgi Konstantinidi, mayor of Giresun. Teşekkür ederiz.
Teşekkür ederim Sayın Başkan.
Thank you very much. Well, the topic of my paper is about Captain Yorgi Konstantini Pasha, who served as the mayor of Giresun between 1885 and 1904 for 19 consecutive years. I will talk about his commercial career and career as a mayor. This shows us a good example of coexistence of Turkish people, Armenians, and Greeks. He has served as mayor for long years, and by the way, he's called Captain Yorgi. So before that, he had a fleet of 6 or 7 ships, and he is a representative of the Greek bourgeoisie in Giresun. He has a strong position in economy, and he's represented as an important figure among the Greek society of Giresun as well. So he served as mayor for 19 years, and we don't know how Captain Yorgi was elected as mayor. We don't have any data. Well, my paper is based on the Ottoman archives, so I don't have any information with regards to how he was elected. But the most important indicator for us concerning his election is the demographic statistics or demographic figures of Giresun. According to this, in 1486, the city composed of 794 people, and 83% of this was Christian. However, in 1555, we can say that 85% of the population was Christian, which corresponds to 1,630 people. And in 1583, the population of the city was 3,200 people, and 54% of it was Christian. In 1831, the census was conducted, and we have a demographic book, the population book, that was actually used between 1835 and 1845. According to this, in downtown we had, or they had, 933 Muslim men, 594 Greek, and 111 Armenian men. So 43% of the city is composed of non-Muslims. So on this book it says that 260 of the Greek people are coming from Gümüşhane to Giresun. They are called as migrants in the books, and majority of them actually came to Giresun After the 1827-1828 Ottoman-Russian War, they used to live in Gümüşhane. They were miners, and they left Gümüşhane after the war and came and settled in Giresun. In 1880s, the French Queenet visited Giresun, and he says that in 1887, in the downtown area, there were 3,588 Muslims, 3,906 Greek people, and 946 Armenians. So in total, 8,440 people were living in Giresun downtown, which means that 58% of the entire population was composed of non-Muslims. So Captain Yorgi served as mayor for 19 years, as I have said, and this figure explains it. So there was actually almost a balance between the Muslim and non-Muslim population, but it's also because of this demographic situation that he could serve as a mayor for a long time. So he is originally from Gümüşhane. Captain Yorgi also migrated to Giresun from Gümüşhane after the Russian war, and he originally comes from Kopus village. It used to be known as Kopsa village. So his great ancestors were miners, John Kiziroğlu, and his father is Captain Konstantin. They used to reside in Giresun's Gonca neighborhood, and they were very wealthy, and we can understand this because they were paying a lot of tax, jizya tax for non-Muslims. So if you were paying high tax, it was 25. If you were paying middle, it was 56, and if you were paying low level tax, it was 11. So they were paying a high level of income, jizya tax. So they came to Giresun, and we learn from Louis Rambert, a traveler from Switzerland, that he was wealthy. And by the way, I have two references. One was the Pontus Encyclopedia, and another was a book, according to which Captain Yorgi was born in 1820. So Captain Yorgi lost his father when he was a child. He studied in Giresun. He was involved in maritime activities. He worked as a crew member in boats, and he was talented. So soon he became a captain, and he started to be involved in commercial activities through the sea. He married the daughter of a merchant, Elizabeth, and after they got married, they had three daughters. And the commercial activities of the family were not only limited to the Giresun area. The brother of Captain Yorgi, Demolis, was involved in commercial activities with Marseille. In 1878, his son also became one of the biggest hazelnut exporters of Europe. So the most important innovation that the family brought to Giresun was a machine to break the shell of hazelnuts, because initially hazelnuts were actually the shell was broken through mills that were used by hand, but he brought a machine to Giresun thanks to which they were able to break the shells of 150 scales of hazelnuts. Previously, if you were doing this manually, you would only be able to break the shells of 40 to 50 scales of hazelnuts. So they actually increased the production to threefold. So before Captain Yorgi was elected as mayor, he first became a member of the municipal council. So the municipal structure or organization was established in Giresun in 1869, and we had other members that were members of the family municipal council. And starting from 1881, he serves as the mayor. 85, he serves as the mayor. Well, he served as mayor for long years, as I have said, 19 years. And no mayor has broken this record yet since the Ottoman period. And some circles in Turkey say that This long period of mayorship is the result of the Tanzimat period, whereby the non-Muslims got a lot of freedoms. And there was good also cooperation between the non-Muslim community. We don't know how he was elected, but Sultan Abdulhamid appointed him as mayor with a special order. That's what is claimed, but I checked the archives. I couldn't find any document showing this. He really helped Giresun develop a lot. He carried out a lot of settlement activities. The original municipality building that they use at the moment is constructed by him. He made pavements all around the city. So he carried out a lot of nice infrastructure activities. The two main roads that go all the way up to Giresun Castle were actually constructed through his mayorship. We have Gazi Street, the biggest street in Giresun. On the anniversary of the coronation of Abdulhamid, that street was called as the Hamidiye Street, and he inaugurated the street at that time. So Rambar, who interviewed him, talks about the nice streets of the city, and he asks the mayor if they faced any problems when constructing these roads. And the Captain Yorgi says that everyone loves my family here, they respect my father, and now they are respecting me. Even if I say that I would expropriate the gardens or properties of someone, nobody would reject to me. But we learn that he demolished some buildings to construct the roads. For instance, a madrasa was demolished by him for the construction of the road, but he constructed another madrasa somewhere else. So we can see his services in other places as well, and because of his services in 1887 he was awarded with a Mecidiye order or decoration. The Giresun Telegram Office building was also constructed by him. Şahbazoğlu, Usta Panayır and his company were involved in the tender, and he was awarded the tender to construct this building. I also talked about the fact that the current mayor's building was constructed by him. So in the memoirs of Rambar, it says that when Captain Yorgi was carrying out all these services, he did not only use the municipal budget, but he also used his own funds. Out of his own pocket, he also contributed to the city. And the activities of Yorgi are explained as follows by the governor. Giresun is the best or one of the nicest cities in the Black Sea coast. It has an important place in Black Sea, and Captain Yorgi Pasha constructed year over year all these nice streets, buildings, which even made Giresun more beautiful. He opened nice streets opening all the way to the sea, and he constructed roads through which you can have access to the Giresun Castle. There is also a nice garden, a yard, that he inaugurated on the anniversary of coronation of Sultan Abdulhamid. Nice pavements alongside the roads and streets struck you. And if you take a look at all these things, we can say that the contribution of Captain Yorgi are highly appreciated. There is a document dating from 1896. In the archives that contains a complaint about Captain Yorgi that is written to the Ministry of Interior. There are some accusations against him. They say that Captain Yorgi collected 2.5 million kuruş from the citizens for the expenditures of the municipality, and he didn't take this decision with the municipality council, but it was his own personal decision to take this money from the citizens. He is also using his own company to construct all the civil works of the municipality. He participates in tenders, and he is also putting pressure on the bakeries of the city so that they will buy their flour from him. And he gives monetary fines or sanctions if they don't buy their flour from his company. So this petition or this complaint is given to the central government, and the government suggests that Captain Yorgi is taken away from his position, he's removed from his position, but we don't have any document if he was actually punished because he continued to serve as mayor for another 5 years after this petition. Yes, in the initial years of Republic, there is a race, the boat races that are conducted since the beginning of the Republican era, and we believe that he initiated this. You actually use a mast, a pole covered with oil, and you tried to walk on this. It's put into the sea, and you try to walk on it. So we believe that these types of races were initiated during his mayorship. So there are also some observations about him and Giresun. It says Giresun used to be one of the first class cities of our country. The buildings were nicely built, the streets were large enough, and you would feel very comfortable and happy when you would walk around the streets. Normally, if I walk around cities, I always see abandoned, old, rundown buildings. However, this nice, neat looking city made me feel very happy, and I wasn't able to understand how this city was built so nicely. But Giresun owes this success and this beauty to a mayor who has died years ago, and his name is Captain Yorgi. So Captain Yorgi Pasha and his story is known all in all the adjacent cities, and his efforts have been highly appreciated. This person served as the mayor of Giresun for long years, and he spent all his money and wealth for the organization of this city. He fought against anyone who wanted to put barriers in front of him. He never yielded. He was very determined in his manners, and most of the time to reach his goals, he spent his own personal wealth. He had a lot of debts, but thanks to his efforts, Giresun is still a nice city, even though it has been long time since he passed away. And even though if no construction was made after his death, Giresun still looks nice. So we would like to salute him and pay tribute to his august memory. Again, in May 1999, another person, Şeref Ünaydın, visited Giresun, and he has his observations about the city and Yorgi. Captain Yorgi, is it possible to come to Giresun and not to hear this name? Is it possible not to see the appreciation towards this name? This person has made this city a nice city. He is a loyal soul. He loved us. We loved him. And he is also very loyal to the city and the state as well. So when we take a look at all the works done by Captain Yorgi, the buildings he constructed, the streets and the churches in Giresun, all these things made it possible to Giresun have a nice aesthetic structure. We can say that he most probably died in 1904 or 1905. We don't know exactly when he died. But Sambas Aksandis, one of the observers I quoted from, talks about his funeral. So in his memoir, can I also read this? Okay. After his death, it says, during the funeral ceremony, the people were really showing a lot of affection upon his death. There was a mourning of 1 week in all the public institutions. All the schools were closed for 3 days, both Greek, Armenian and Muslim, and all the military officials and the notables came to his funeral. I also participated in his funeral as a third grader. I was a child and I witnessed how sad people were. All the officials of the city were present there, and his golden sword was carried out on a golden tray by a certain official, and they marched through the streets and they came to the church, they performed the mass, and then he was buried to his monument. Well, he constructed a monument for himself. The Russian architects were commissioned to construct a monumental grave for him, whereby his wife and children are also buried. And after the population exchange, His, by the way, his grave is known as a guild monument. When you come, when you enter the city from Ordu, you can see it from far away. That monument is so large. In 1956, when they were extending the Giresun-Trabzon road, this monument was removed. His relics, the bones, have been protected and then sent to Marseille later on. During his term as mayor, he was supported by both Muslims, Armenians and Greeks. And his grave, by the way, he died in 1904, I have said. So this society was living in peace, but soon after that, in the 1920s, we see another mayor. His name is Osman the Lame. Even though there is a difference of 10 or 15 years between the two mayors, we can see that there is a huge change in the society. The different communities became enemies to each other. And we can't just understand how this happened. Thank you very much.
Okay, we have 15 minutes for questions, so I open the floor for questions, please.
I have a question for all the three speakers, actually, and each and every one of them actually focused on a certain case. We make all these micro histories as well, and I would kindly ask all the speakers to tell us how these three stories are linked to the history writing in the Ottoman times, and how. What sort of an alternative do these stories pose to the official history? What would you say about these stories and the official history writing or history making?
Çok teşekkür ediyorum. I think I have a personal reason that I want to ask Sezai Bey a question. 1959 Giresun'da.
I was born in Giresun in 1959. That's why my question is directed to you. At the end of your speech, you said something, and I feel compelled to ask about this now. After this captain died, his kids or his family, what did they do until 1915? Did they coexist, live together with the local population or not? Do you know anything about this? Or can you share other resources with us? One more question, please. I may pronounce this wrong, but please correct me. Mr. Colin. My question is to Mr. Colin and to Sezai Bey. In 1915 and 1907, Armenian massacres took place. And my question is, well, Gulbenkians were not affected by those events. How do you reach that conclusion from their own archives, their own letters, or from other places? And Sezai Bey, Osman the Lame, when was he the mayor in Giresun? Thank you. My question is for Mr. Colin as well. It is actually quite similar to the question that was posed just now. You said that 1915 is a genocide. Genocide is about annihilation of a people. And that's my understanding of a genocide. So, in 1915, the Gulbenkian family, how come they were not affected by this genocide? How come they were able to save themselves? That's my question. Two more questions, please, because our time is limited. Any other questions, please?
Here and one at the back. We'll take those and then
we get back to the panel.
My question is the one Jonathan implied he would like asked, but I'd like to take it a step further. The whole discussion, no, the concepts of homeland and belonging and identity in the various Gulbenkian generations, families. I remember when survivors were asked, you know, would you go to Armenia now? They used to say, I don't know where Armenia is. I know where my village is. So if you would talk a little bit about that, please.
Thanks. And there's a last question at the back.
I have a question about the Gulbenkians. Is he really called Mr. 10% because of these petroleum commissions? And secondly, is it 5%? Okay. And also, and he was in, did he have really good relations with Abdul Hamid? Because Abdul Hamid, I mean, did he have a share or did he have an interest in this? And my second question is, this is a wealthy family and they have an art collection and they wanted him or the family to turn it into a museum in Üsküdar when he was born. And it was turned down in 1950s. And now apparently they have a museum in Lisbon. Is that correct? Thank you.
Panelists, if you can be brief, let's start with Oya Hanım.
Let me tell you how I started this research. Maybe this is going to help us understand the paradigm, how I started working on them. I started focusing on the Kayseri Armenians and the result of deportations, and Ibranosians had a branch in Kayseri, and all the documents that I read mentioned Yosefian and Ibranosian stores and how their goods were confiscated or purchased. The Yosefian store, those goods were under the mortgage of Deutsche Bank, so Deutsche Bank had to be dealt with. But for Ibranosian, this is what was said. The Ministry of Interior talks to him, and for the purchasing of these goods, we will get back to you, they say. In the Kayseri example, there's serious confiscation left and right. So an Armenian merchant, their store, why are the goods being bought, not confiscated? That was a question mark in my head, and then I started to initiate in this research. And also, in our approach to the deportations, I think we tend to skip these class-related differences. But actually, we are talking about an upper-class Armenian person who is in close relations with the state. And thanks to these close relations, perhaps this person does not experience what the commons did, especially during the war years. And that was his case. So there's a class-related difference here as well. And the links with the state actually had an important role to play in all of this. That's why I wanted to focus on this, because these are usually overlooked in our making sense of that period in history. And I think the telling of these stories is going to make the history of deportations richer and help us understand certain things that haven't been discussed before. Thank you.
I think I counted about 6 or 7 questions. I'm going to have to leave some of them unanswered, specifically the one about homeland, because it's just too big. Firstly, there were 2 questions about the genocide. How do I know that the Gulbenkian family, Galust, Batrik, were not affected? Well, and also, how do we know, therefore, that there was a genocide if they weren't affected? So they are indeed linked questions. We know they weren't affected because they weren't in the country in 1915. Badrik was in New York, Kalust was moving back and forth between London and Paris. So they had left the country, they were moving around, they were very wealthy, so they were able to stay in hotels. We know that more distant Gulbenkian relatives, as in second cousins, were victims of the genocide, because in 1920, one of them writes to Gulbenkian asking for help. She is the wife of Parse Gulbenkian, who is a very distant relation of Kalust. And she says that she was from the Ankara Gulbenkians, and that in 1915, the Armenians were all rounded up. The men and boys were taken to the edge of the city where they were shot, and the women were then taken on forced marches to what she calls the killing places. Fortunately, on the way there, she is taken in by some people and therefore lives to tell the tale. All the men and boys of the Ankara Armenian community had been shot. So yes, there is evidence in this archive to support the claim that this is a genocide. In terms of the Abdulhamid, yes, Abdulhamid was very interested in oil, and his Ministry of the Civil List was buying up lands in the vilayet of Mosul and Baghdad from the 1860s, advised by his Armenian Minister of Civil List. So Kalust Gulbenkian claims in his memoirs that he was the first person to write a report for the Ministry of the Civil List for Abdulhamid, drawing attention to the fact that there was petroleum there. But we know from the archives that there are hundreds of these kind of reports from the time and from earlier times. So he was not the first to say to the Sultan, look, you've got to exploit this oil. The museum in Üsküdar is something that came up yesterday and which comes up again and again. And there is no evidence that Kalust had any intention ever to create a museum in Üsküdar. He did think at some points of retiring here in the 1920s, but changed his mind. His art collection, he thought first of having it, leaving it to London, then he thought of giving it to Washington, and finally he gave it to Lisbon. So I know there was a proposal to create a Gulbenkian house in Üsküdar, but that was never mentioned in any of Gulbenkian's wills or letters. And finally, for perhaps a more interesting example, someone said, what does this case study bring to the understanding of Ottoman history? What I think Kalust owes his fortune to, his 5%, is that he always saw the world without borders. I think that wonderful short anecdote that explains this approach best. In 1925, when they are trying to decide where the border between Iraq and Turkey is, there are various international commissions, the Brussels line, everyone's involved. And the Turkish Petroleum Company is very concerned that they want the oil to be on the British, i.e. Iraqi side. Carlos Gulbenkian writes to the head of Turkish Petroleum saying, the cartographer to the Minorski mission that is drawing the line went to school with me, and he's an Armenian, Kanzadian, and if I give him £2,000, he will draw the border wherever you want it to be. I mean, borders, why do you go to Versailles to negotiate a border? It's a business matter, nothing else. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sezai Bey.
Sizin sorunuza cevap vereceğim. Kaptan Yorgi.
Captain Yorgi died in 05 and the family remained in Giresun. His son was involved in commerce in Marseille, and in Giresun his daughter and son-in-law remained. Madame Pavlidi is his daughter, and until 27 she ran the only cinema, the only cinema theater in Giresun. And one of the son-in-laws was from Kayseri, son of Panayot Murat. And in 1920, with Osman the Lame from Batum, all the way to Istanbul, they actually sold fuel oil. And there was a conflict between them. And one of the sons-in-law, Deli Eroğlu, as he was known, in the Ottoman records, Deli Gavuroğlu, in 21, in the court martial, he was subject to execution. I don't know exactly, but before the deportations or after the deportations, I don't know when they left, but they left Giresun somewhere along this line. You asked about the mayorship of Osman the Lame. That was between 1919 and 1920. and he was being searched for deportations. He left Giresun, and then he was pardoned. And in July 1919, he went back to Giresun, and he became the mayor. And the mayorship went on until 1920, when he joined the parliament in Ankara.
Thank you, everybody. So we close the panel, and 15 minutes coffee break. Thank you.